So in this video, I will be asking a series of questions about the digestive tract and giving you a little time to think of the answer to help you figure out what do you still know versus what do you need to work on. So mostly I'm going to be focusing on the digestive tract, but keep your eyes out because sometime in the future I'll probably make another video with some of the accessory organs like the liver, tongue, pancreas in greater detail that I'm going to go into here. All right, so first I want you to think, what is this entire thing? What two bones is it made of? What is this? What is this? So this is the hard palate, which in the back has the palatine bone, in the front, the maxilla. This is the soft palate and uvula. So when you open your mouth, the thing dangling in the back is the uvula. What is the function of that? When you swallow, the uvula swings up and closes off your nose so your food doesn't go up your nose, so it goes down. On the base of the tongue, we can see there's this bit of tissue, and then there's this. So this is the lingual tonsil. This is the pharyngeal tonsil. So those are the tonsils that you might be able to see in the back of your mouth that a lot of people get taken out when they're kids. What do we call this entire tube? What is this region of the tube versus this region? So this is the oropharynx, which is above the laryngopharynx, and they're both lined with what type of epithelium? Stratified squamous, because stratified squamous will protect you from the food that you're swallowing. It has multiple layers. What are we seeing here, 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 and here? So this is the esophagus, stomach, liver, and gallbladder. So we swallow our food, it goes down our esophagus, which is lined with also stratified squamous. Then the food has to pass through a muscular ring here, which is the cardiac sphincter. It's the cardiac sphincter, or sometimes the lower esophageal sphincter, but we can call it the cardiac sphincter as well because this region of the stomach is the cardia. All right, so once the food passes into the stomach, what is the stomach lined with? Simple columnar epithelium. We no longer have to worry about friction because we've got like mucus, acid, it's fine. What do we call this region of the stomach? This region, this region. So this is the fundus. A fundus is a dome. This is the body. The tail is the pylorus. So what do we call this little ring of muscle? What do we call all the little folds? And what's the purpose of those folds? And what do we call this here? And what is that the start of? So these ridges are rugae, and they allow the stomach to expand just like the pleats in your pants let your stretchy pants expand. This ring of muscle is the pyloric sphincter. Food exits the stomach through the pyloric sphincter to get into the duodenum, which is the first part of the small intestine. All right, so in the duodenum, there are little ridges. What are those? And then what is this organ? And then what is this duct? And this duct. So the ridges are the, you could call them plicae circularis or circular folds. This organ is the pancreas. This duct is the common bile duct. It is the common bile duct because the duct from the gallbladder and the duct from the liver come together. They're both carrying bile. They come together to make the common bile duct. This white duct here is the pancreatic duct, the main pancreatic duct. So once your common bile duct and main pancreatic duct come together, they form a shared tube. What is the name of the tube? And then when the tube enters the duodenum, it doesn't look great on this model, but it's kind of like there's like a little volcano that surrounds the opening of the tube, like a little hill. So the tube itself is the hepatopancreatic ampulla. The little nub that surrounds the opening of the hepatopancreatic ampulla is the duodenal papilla. So we didn't talk about them, but all the taste buds on your tongue are, you know, fungiform papilla, filiform papilla. A papilla is always a little nub shape. All right, so I'm about to remove this, which is the transverse colon. So the duodenum is really short. It ends about there. After the duodenum, what is the next region of the small intestine? And this region. So this is the jejunum. The last region of the small intestine is the ileum. The ileum connects to this. So what is this? What is this little muscle? What's that guy? And then this here. So the first region of the large intestine is the cecum. This little ring of muscle, that is the ileocecal sphincter. So the ileocecal sphincter opens to allow stuff from the small intestine to pass into the large intestine. This is the appendix. This is the ascending colon. What is this? This, the straight portion there that I already said the name of, this, and then there's kind of a bend there, and the last region. So this is the right colic flexure. You also might see it called the hepatic flexure because hepatic is related to the liver. It's on the side with the liver. So this is the right colic flexure. Straight across is the transverse colon. On the other side is the left colic flexure, or you could say splenic flexure because it's near the spleen. This going down, descending colon. This last little bend here, you can't really see it that well, but it makes like a little S shape. That is the sigmoid colon. The sigmoid colon leads to the rectum. All right, so we said the stomach was lined with what type of epithelium? Simple columnar. What about all the other regions? So from the stomach all the way through the rectum, it is lined with simple columnar. At the very end, at the anal canal, it will transition back to stratified squamous, because now we have to worry about friction again, because the feces are going to be hard. We have to worry about our feces abrading us, so we have stratified squamous in the anal canal. So you can think of the digestive system as a stratified squamous sandwich, because it's stratified squamous in the beginning, from the mouth to the esophagus, simple columnar all the way in the middle, and the very end, stratified squamous again. Alright, so these little individual pouches are called haustra. And then what do we call this band we're seeing here? So that's the teniae coli, and it's kind of like a little drawstring that is cinching up your large intestine to create those little haustra. All right, so last thing I'm going to ask is not really a lab question, but I think it's always good to think about it while you're looking at it. What is the function of the small intestine versus the main function of the large intestine? So, hint, they both do absorption, but how are the small intestine and large intestine different? So the small intestine is completing the digestive process and breaking down your nutrients into their smallest forms so that you can absorb your nutrients into your bloodstream. So the small intestine, we're absorbing nutrients. In that process, you have to add a lot of water. You're just mixing water into it as you're breaking it down. The job of the large intestine is to reabsorb all of that water. So diarrhea, that's going to be caused by it's moving through your system too fast to reabsorb back the water. All right, that's all I have to say about that. I hope it was helpful. Have a great day and have fun learning.